So now that we've looked at eyewitness testimony, let's transition to our second example of external evidence that helps increase our confidence in trusting the Bible. This is physical and scientific evidence. In determining the Bible's historical reliability, scholars use the same criteria used to test all historical documents, whether they're biblical or non-biblical. As with most ancient literature, there are no known currently existing original manuscripts of the Bible. So without original manuscripts, the question scholars ask is, how reliable are the copies? In considering this question, they examine the number of manuscripts available and the time interval between that original document and the currently existing copies. Here are a few quotes from some well-respected scholars on this topic. One writes, on the basis of manuscript tradition alone, the works that made up the Christian's New Testament were the most frequently copied and widely circulated books of antiquity. Another biblical scholar writes, there is no body of ancient literature in the world which enjoys such a wealth of good and textual attestation as the New Testament. Okay, so let's bring these quotes alive visually using Josh McDowell's book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict. It provides a telling image via a graph of this massive amount of historical documentation. You should see the graph now. McDowell starts with the height of the number of existing manuscripts for the average classical writer, think of Homer or Plato, measuring 4 feet on his graph. He then contrasts that with the height of One World Trade Center in New York City, 1,792 feet. Next, he contrasts that with the height of the number of New Testament manuscripts, measuring 1 mile high, which is 5,280 feet. Then he contrasts that with the number of Old Testament manuscripts, measuring 1.5 miles high, or 7,920 feet. Just so you know, I had to look up all this math. I didn't know any of this math. Finally, he completes the graph with the height of the entire number of biblical manuscripts, Old Testament and New, measuring 2.5 miles high. That is 13,200 feet, which is about the height of the Grand Teton mountain range in the Western United States. That's a lot of documents and compelling evidence for the trustworthiness of God's word. Now, if that's not enough, let's move from the height of the biblical manuscripts in existence to date to the number of manuscripts to date. I've pulled these numbers from the same source. It's important to note these numbers constantly change due to new manuscript discoveries, meaning the numbers will increase but not decrease. So as of 2017, the total number of New Testament, Greek and non-Greek manuscripts is 23,986. Remember, this is not the number of pages or the number of books, it's entire manuscripts. The total number of Old Testament manuscripts is 42,300. One of the reasons scholars value the Old Testament manuscripts is they help verify the authenticity of the New Testament manuscripts that quote them. And then add these together, y'all, the total number of biblical manuscript evidences are 66,286. That's a lot of documents and more compelling evidence for the case we're building for the trustworthiness of God's word. In fact, it's 2.5 miles worth of compelling evidence. All right, let's add to these incredible statistics another important facet of the reliability of Scripture. The fact that the time between the composing of the books, especially the New Testament books and letters, and the earliest existing copies is relatively brief, some portions copied within a century or so after the writing of the original documents. Biblical scholar Sir Frederick Kenyon describes it like this: the interval between the dates of the original composition and the earliest, they use the word extant, but it's existing copies become so small as to be in fact negligible. And the last foundation for any doubt that the scriptures have come down to us substantially as they were written has now been removed. Both the authenticity and the general integrity of the books of the New Testament may be regarded as firmly established. All right. I've given you so many statistics. So let's bring them to life by taking a trip back in time to learn about one of the Bible's most interesting and exciting scientific discoveries, the finding of the Dead Sea Scrolls in Qumran. The Dead Sea Scrolls demonstrated unequivocally that the Jews were faithful in their transcription and preservation of biblical manuscripts. This reverence for the scriptures was summed up long ago by the first century Jewish historian Flavius Josephus. He says, "We have given practical proof of our reverence for our own scriptures. For although such long ages have now passed, no one has ventured either to add or to remove or to alter a syllable. And it is an instinct with every Jew from the day of his birth to regard them as the decrees of God, to abide by them, and if need be, cheerfully die for them." And this is exactly what the Essene priests I'm about to tell you did. They risked their lives to preserve those treasured and sacred documents. I'm sharing an image with you now so that you can see with your eyes where this discovery took place. My daughter and I took this picture when we visited Qumran several years ago during our trip to Israel. Qumran is an archaeological site located on the northwestern shore of the Dead Sea in the Judean Desert. What you're looking at are the caves where some of these Dead Sea scrolls were found. Scholars believe Essene priests, men who devoted their lives to writing and preserving the sacred texts, established this settlement outside Jerusalem in 70 AD to escape Roman persecution. They fled Jerusalem, taking with them the scrolls containing the Holy Scriptures and hid them in these caves. Centuries later, 1947 to be exact, tradition has it a young shepherd boy looking for a lost goat came across one of these caves. Thinking the goat might be inside, he tossed a rock into the cave. Instead of finding his goat, he heard the sound of breaking pottery. He returned to the cave with some of his fellow shepherds to investigate, and they found inside these tall clay jars. When they peeked into the jars, they found some contained linen-wrapped scrolls. Eventually, the scrolls found their way to someone who authenticated them as books of the Bible, dating as far back as 150 BC. And one was a 24-foot long, full transcription of the book of Isaiah, 1,000 years older than any previously known copy of the transcript. Since 1947, thousands more scroll fragments, most made from animal skin and parchment, have been discovered in the Qumran caves. Scholars estimate more than 800 manuscripts were found there. One scholar writes of these scrolls, "The Old Testament books from Qumran are those which we find in our Bibles today. Minor textual variations occur as they do in any document which depends on hand copying for multiplication, but the biblical text may be regarded as essentially reliable." And we're going to talk about those textual variants in a few minutes. But what made this personal for me was learning that some scholars believe that the Isaiah scroll found in those caves could have been the very same one Jesus read from in Luke 4:16 through 20, a passage familiar to many. Jesus went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to Jesus. Unrolling it, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. I remember standing in awe before this very scroll when the Dead Sea Scroll exhibit came to Charlotte, overwhelmed at the magnitude of what stood before me. My son asked, "Why are you crying, Mom?" And I could barely speak. I said, "Bo, the holy and sacred words written on this parchment are the very words of God we read when I tuck you in bed at night." Friends, let my words sink in. The holy and sacred words those priests watched over, the words for which they risked their lives, are the very same words I hold in my hand right now. We're building our case. The eyewitness testimony and physical and scientific evidence we've studied have provided incredibly compelling evidence for the trustworthiness of God's word. And we don't stop here. There's more. More reasons we can have confidence in the book we hold in our hands. We've considered trustworthy eyewitnesses. We've examined credible physical and scientific evidence, both external evidence.